Good morning and welcome to the Center for Spiritual Living in the heart of Las Cruces, where your center is alive and well, and where our vision is a world in loving partnership for the good of all. I'm Bob Greer. I'm your board president and your practitioner in service this morning. I have a few announcements and activities to let you know about. Be sure to join our weekly Spiritual Circle discussion group via Zoom on Wednesdays at 11 a.m. Feel free to join as you can. This weekly discussion covers various articles from the monthly Science of Mind magazine, and see our newsletter for information on how to join this discussion. And if you need the magazine, we have them here at the center. Just give us a call. Coming up in September, Reverend Bonnie will teach a class on building a healing consciousness. The dates and times are not exact yet, as we're waiting to hear what the response is on this class. So please, if you're interested, send her an email or contact the office and get on the list, and we'll discuss a date and a time. In August, noon Zoom will be the last Sunday in August, where we share our thoughts on this month's topic. So I hope that you'll join us on August the 30th. An email reminder about the meeting with a link will be sent out on the 29th. And also you can find that on our website. For more information on any of these activities and other events, please visit our website at www.csl-lascruces.org. That's www.csl-lascruces.org. And there you can sign up for our weekly newsletter, submit a prayer request, anything that you'd like. So lots of information there. We are grateful for those of you who that are giving your tithes and offerings to our beloved center. As you know, even though we're not currently meeting in person, our monthly obligations continue, and we are so grateful for your support. You can share your tithes by using our website. You can mail them in, or if you want to bring them by in person, you can drop them through the mail slot at the back door there. And speaking of tithes, as you know, we are a tithing community, and every month 10% of everything we collect is tithed back to the local community. For the month of August, we are gifting two special places that are near and dear to us. The first is to Randy Brown, our videographer and musician extraordinaire, who without his dedication and hard work, none of this would be possible. So as a show of appreciation for all the time and effort that he's done since this COVID thing has started and everything has shifted online, we are gifting him. And then the second smaller part of that donation this month will go to Unity, to our sister New Thought community, Unity of Las Cruces, where we share our physical space in this building, and we're so grateful for them as well. As your practitioner in service today, I want to remind you that practitioners are available to pray with you over the phone. And if you do not know how to get in touch with us, just contact the office and they'll have one of them give you a call. There is also a prayer request button, as I mentioned earlier, on the website. You can go there and submit a prayer. Those prayers are privately only shared with the practitioner. And then with the prayer team that meets every week via Zoom with a combination of ministers and practitioners from our three local New Thought Centers, Unity, Wellsprings, and CSL. So please take advantage of that. So at this time, it's time for song, silence, and prayer.
In this moment, I am clear is this moment. What I am,
So just opening to this moment, knowing that there is one power and one presence. It's right here, right now, as it is in all ways, at all times. Knowing that I am one with that power, that I am connected to that spirit, and that everything I do is a reflection of that spirit in action. And as I claim this truth for myself, I claim this truth for each person, knowing that everyone is connected to this divine power, to this divine new intelligence and first cause. So knowing that today's service is divinely blessed, that everything that's said is exactly what needs to be expressed and touches each one of us and reminds us that we are all connected. And so I simply say, and so it is. So for today's reading, I have two, actually, readings. So out of the Science of Mind, these are prayers from the back of the book. And this is, the first one is on page 512. It's called, O Soul of Mine, Look Out and See. O soul of mine, look out and see. Look up and know thy freedom. Be not cast down or dismayed. Be uplifted within me and exalt, for thy salvation has come. Behold the wonders of the great whole and the marvels of the universe. Look out and see thy good. It is not afar off, but is at hand. Prepare thyself to accept and believe, to know and live. Let life enter and live through thee, soul of mine, and rejoice that thou hast vision so fair and so complete. Rejoice that the perfect whole is so completely reflected through thee. My light has come. And the second reading is One with Perfect Action on page 525. I am one with perfect action. Everything that I do, say, or think is quickened into action through this right understanding and this correct knowing. The harmonious action of the great whole operates through me now and at all times. I am carried along by this right action, and I am compelled to do the right thing at the right time. There is nothing in me that can hinder these actions from flowing through me. The action of God is the only action. Thank you.
When the night has come and the land is dark and the moon is the only light we'll see, no, I won't be afraid. No, I won't be afraid. Just as long is she standing, stand by me. People, won't you listen now, stand by me. Oh, won't you stand by me. Oh, stand, stand by me, stand by me. If the sky we look upon tumble and fall, or the mountain should crumble to the sea, I won't cry, I won't cry, no, I won't shed a tear, just as long as you stand by me. People, won't you listen now, stand by me. Oh, just stand by me.
Good morning, and welcome again. Thank you so much for joining us on this August 16th Sunday celebration. I'm Reverend Bonnie, the community spiritual leader here at the Center for Spiritual Living in the heart of Las Cruces. And so I want to ask you, how is that FPP going? You don't know what FPP is? Well, I guess you're going to have to watch my talk from 2 weeks ago. That forgiveness, that preparedness, and that practice, how's it going? Who have you welcomed back into your heart recently? Who have you welcomed into your heart that maybe you'd never welcomed there before? It's about time for me to start calling all the congregants again, so I'm hoping we can have some discussions around these questions. I'm looking forward to asking you how things are going, how you're preparing, what you're learning, what's new in your life. How have you started to deepen in your spiritual practice? Recently, I had a conversation with a young member of our center, and she said that she had been working really hard at doing some healing work in her life. And she asked me, she said, after all these years that you've been doing this healing work and doing this practice, do you ever get to just relax and sort of rest? Well, I understood the question, but I also knew that my answer would be really important. So I had to think for a moment. And then what I shared with her is that after years and years of putting into practice this spiritual practice, I realized that life still happens. Things still go on in my life. I'm still impacted by things. But what I find is that I grab those spiritual tools a lot faster today than I used to. I grab them right away and go into that place where I know how these spiritual tools work for me. I don't allow myself to wallow as long as I used to. I don't stay in the sadness and the depression or anger, whatever it is. I just grab those tools and get to work a lot faster now than I used to do. And then I thought some more, and I asked her, what was it like when you were growing up? What levels of drama did you live with? Did you live with drama? And she said, oh, yes, my family had a lot of drama going on. She said, you're always looking out and waiting for that next shoe to drop. And I said, so when you live with that level of drama, and you're always worried and fearful that that shoe is going to drop, I said, how does the idea of not having that experience look to you? And she thought about it a minute, went, oh, I see, yeah, it could be a little boring. So part of what happens is when we grow up with those levels of drama, we get addicted to that adrenaline that's moving through our bodies. And the idea of not having it starts to feel like it could be a boring thing. We certainly don't see movies about people living their life with everything flowing perfectly. We would think of that as boring. So I told her she needed, first of all, to start visualizing what that life would look like, to start visualizing how it would be to be able to rest and relax in her spiritual practice. And then I also told her that the other thing that has happened for me is over the years of practicing and grabbing those tools and putting them to use, I now can tell myself when something happens in my life, okay, you've been here. You've done this, you can get through it. It doesn't feel like the end of the world like it used to. I now know, okay, here's another thing, let's take these tools, let's get to work. I know that I can survive it and that I will get through. So how does this relate to this month's topic of inclusion in action? Well, I believe that drama, as it shows up in our lives, is very often because of or involves that protecting of our space. Whether we're protecting our assets, our emotional selves, or as she and I were talking about, what she referred to as that inner child, that inner emotional self, however you want to refer to it, often the drama comes from us protecting ourselves, and as we do that, we are excluding sometimes even those we love from our space. So when we're in this state, I realize that it's important to start by embracing that inner self, embrace that emotional self, and just take a moment to see why he or she is scared. What are we afraid of in there? The last time I spoke, I talked about the gift that we've been given being time and solitude. And so we can take the time then to listen to our inner fears. Make the space for those fears to come up and be expressed, to hear what's going on in there, and to care for that inner emotional self or inner child. We can cry, we can rock, we can listen, we can journal, and definitely love and focus. Focus on what's going on and keep asking that question, what is he or she inside really afraid of? In a lot of the classes that I teach, I bring in an exercise that I learned at the Holmes Institute. And in that exercise, we pair off and we ask each other, what do you really want? And the person who's asking listens as the person answers, and then the only response is yes, and what do you really want? We don't ask any more questions, we don't clarify, we don't comment, we just keep asking yes, and what do you really want? And I've shared that exercise in here before, and I know some of you have tried it. But I was thinking this week about asking, what are you really afraid of? And the response being, I understand. And what are you really afraid of? I understand. And what are you really afraid of? To start asking ourselves that question and asking each other. In the July Science of Mind magazine, Reverend Masando has an article, Taking Action While Staying Home. And that's something that I was addressing before. How do we take action while we're staying home? And he said, taking action means washing your hands for 20 seconds. And it also means washing our minds multiple times a day of the fear, panic, and loneliness that can arise. And he has some ideas for how to do that. I like that idea of washing our minds of the fear as it arises. And the only way to do that is to know what that fear is, to listen and let it come up so we can wash our minds of it, so we can move into a way of healing from it. As has been mentioned now several times here on our Sunday services, our country, the Centers for Spiritual Living, and other New Thought communities around this world are now looking at and exploring this topic of diversity and inclusion. We're looking at what does it mean for us, and we're also looking at what is coming up for people. And as Yvette mentioned last week, for some people there's discomfort and there's resistance. For others, there's confusion. We thought we knew that we were inclusive people, and we're being told that we have things to still heal from. We are being told that there's still ways that we're outpicturing racism in the things that we say and do. Or maybe we've had those experiences and we still have places to heal. This whole topic is bringing things up for everyone, and I'm speaking to all people of all races and ethnicities. All the different ways that God expresses, to ask yourself, when you hear this idea of inclusion, what comes up? What fears might be under there? Where have you felt excluded, and where might you be excluding people or individuals or groups of people from your life? And what would inclusion look like and feel like? So as we think about those questions, along with asking ourselves, what do we really want? I'd say let's try asking, what am I really afraid of? And like I said, either do it with a journal or call a practitioner or a friend and do the exercise with each other. What are you really afraid of? I understand. And what are you really afraid of? And as you do that, the root of those fears can be discovered. And you might be surprised at what you discover. You're probably all familiar with Marianne Williamson's statement that starts out, our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. And she concludes that statement with, as we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others. And so as we think about that, our fears could be things that we're afraid of in others. It could be what we're afraid of within our own self. But the fact that we're asking the question and seeking it out means that we're ready to grab the tools that will help us heal those fears. And the biggest tool that I think that we can move into and make use of is that tool that I call prayer. A few weeks ago when I talked about deepening in our spiritual practice, prayer, or as we call it in religious science, spiritual mind treatment is one of the biggest tools that we have to make use of. It's the first action we take. And from the action of prayer, we then discover what the next actions are that we need to take out in the world. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about prayer and what Ernest Holmes says about it. He talks about prayer in several chapters in the Science of Mind text and in a lot of his writings. And on page 169, he says, "We are practicing scientifically when the mind refuses to see the apparent condition and turns to the absolute with a capital A. A scientific treatment cannot be conditioned upon anything that now exists, upon any experience less than perfection." He has a section on page 185 that he called "Turn Entirely from the Condition." And on the next page, he defines that by saying, "Never look at that which you do not wish to experience. No matter what the false condition may be, it must be refuted. The proper kind of denial is based upon the recognition that in reality there is no limitation. A good treatment is always filled with the recognition of the presence of God or good." And so that's how we start a spiritual mind treatment. We start with recognizing what God is, God and good. We think about what is that condition that we'd like to see change, then we turn away from that condition and focus on what God is. In one of those affirmations in the back of the Science of Mind text, which Bob read to us from, there's several back there, he has one called, "I see no evil. I see no evil. I behold only the good. I will not separate and divide. I cannot condemn nor censure, for I know that there is but one in all. I know and love all." So as we think about it, we've been taught then to recognize what God is, to turn away from the condition. So as we think about this topic of diversity and inclusion, many of us were taught way back that our goal was to become colorblind, to only see the person, and I've still heard that recently, "I don't see color, I just see the personality." And so I want you to consider for a moment how that might feel. If we are taught to turn away from the condition because the condition is something we think needs to be fixed, or that we want to see different, or that we think is evil, turning away from seeing color can make a person feel like we believe that color, race, ethnicity is something that needs to be fixed or treated, or even could be akin to evil. Imagine instead that we look at race and ethnicity as part of how God expresses through us all the diverse forms of beauty. I don't go into my garden and say, "I just see flowers. I don't see color. I just see the essence of the flowers." We don't say that. The color of the flower is part of the beauty in their expression. And that is true for people as well. Imagine making that shift in our consciousness. Instead of turning away from seeing color, we need to turn away from the discrimination and hatred that has been developed through time toward people of different colors and races and ethnicities. We need to ask ourselves what it would look like if we could see and celebrate color, see and celebrate diversity in all of God's people and all of God's creation. And as we do that, we can ask ourselves, did anything come up? Are we afraid of anything when we think about looking at life that way? Now, my idea to ask ourselves, what are we afraid of, came to me as I was putting this talk together. So I don't have any experience with asking people that question or seeing how that exercise might work. So if you try this, I would love it if you'd share with me how this works for you, what comes up and what kind of healing work you've been able to do. What I do have experience with is the exercise where we ask, what do you really want? And as I thought about the things that I normally hear when we do that exercise, I realized I could probably deduce what some of those fears are that could be under there as well. So let me give you an example. If someone said to me, I want a car, I need a car, I want a car, I could ask them, and so what do you really want? And as we go through the exercise, what we might get down to is that the person really wants to experience freedom, the freedom to come and go, to be able to go wherever they would like. Now, I could have another person who says they want a car. And as we ask the questions, I could say, and what do you really want? And they could say, well, I need to get to and from work. And I say, what do you really want? Well, I want the salary that comes from going to work. And what do you really want? Well, I want to be able to pay my bills. And what do you really want? I want to feel safe and secure. So when we get to the root of what someone really wants, whether it's freedom or safety and security, a car is one answer. But once we know what the root desire is, there could be a lot of other ways that safety and security and freedom could be realized in someone's life. So as we look at the things that I've commonly heard are the underlying wants, would be safety and security and freedom, also peace of mind, joy, and even life to be alive. So if we think about those, I can then deduce that the correlating fears would be anything where someone feels like their life is in danger. And I realize that often change can make us feel like our life is in danger. So where are we today maybe feeling that our safety and security is being challenged or put in danger? With freedom, we could be afraid that somehow our freedom is being impinged upon or restricted in some way. We could be afraid of chaos or drama or that shoe getting ready to drop. We could be afraid of sadness or depression. And if we've been clinically depressed, we could be afraid of where that depression could lead us, which then would be afraid of death and dying. So all of those fears could be underlying some of what is coming up for people today. So as we consider the topic of diversity and putting inclusion into action, are any of those fears percolating up for you? When we think about our neighborhoods, the life that we're used to living, what is coming up in terms of fears today? And then once those things come up, realize that now we can take them into that healing power of prayer. We can begin the action of prayer. One of the things I think that Ernest Holmes taught that I really think applies to the concept of fear, whenever there's fear involved in our thinking, there's another tool under that heading of prayer called denials and affirmations. And this is used throughout the New Thought movement. And Ernest Holmes talked about it in his chapters 9 and 11 in the Science of Mind text. And he says there's two different methods for treatment. One he called argumentative and the other realization. And the argumentative, or what I've referred to as denials and affirmation, is just what the word implies, he said, though the argument is never with another person. It is a process of mental reasoning in which the practitioner, or the person praying, argues to him or herself about the condition. It is a series of affirmations and denials for the purpose of building up in the mind of the practitioner a state of realization and acceptance. He says the power is in the realization, but there's also power in the argument. So what he's talking about there is that we see that condition that we'd like to see change, and we deny that condition's power over us. We deny that condition's essence as what God really is in the world. And then we turn around and we affirm the truth of our being, and we affirm the principles that we believe in. So that method is referred to as denials and affirmations, or the argumentative method. And I think that's helpful when we're dealing with fears, because we look at that fear and we can deny its power over us and affirm the truth. Now, one of the things that I know is when I'm in the grips of fear, sometimes it's hard to think about how to put things into words. It's hard for me to put those tools to use because I'm too wrapped up in the emotion. And so we've been talking about what's in the back of the Science of Mind text. Ernest Holmes wrote a lot of affirmations. He wrote a lot of short little prayers, and in them are great examples of affirmations and denials and how he works with that. So I'm going to give you another example. If we're talking about diversity and inclusion, He has one in the back, page 513, Seeing the Perfect. My eyes behold the complete and perfect in all creation, in all, over all, and through all. I see the perfect. There is nothing else to see, and no suggestion of otherness can enter my thought. I know only the perfect and the complete. I am perfect and whole now. I see the good. So what is the denial there is where he says there's nothing else to see and no suggestion of otherness. We call that the denial. The affirmation, I know only the perfect and the complete. I am perfect and whole now. And he started with the affirmation, my eyes behold the complete and perfect in all creation. He didn't say we ignore any aspect of creation so it looks perfect to us. We see the perfect and complete in all creation. Well, I also had a phone call this week from a friend who was reading in this thing called You, another book by Ernest Holmes that I highly recommend. And she said she was reading where it said, I am free because the spirit of life in me is perfect. She said, but I don't believe that. And I said, well, what aspect of that don't you believe? She said, I'm not free. I can't go where I want to right now. And if I go somewhere, I have to wear a mask. And I have to think about whether the other people will be wearing a mask. And if they're not, then I really can't go there because I can't risk getting sick, so I'm not free. I said, well, let's think about this a moment. One of the things Ernest Holmes talks about is how our freedom is sometimes also our bondage as humans. How we use that freedom can create for us an experience of freedom or an experience of bondage. And I told her, you are free to go wherever you want. You can make that decision, but Ernest Holmes also talked about how we work with natural law, and we have, for every action, a reaction. We have the natural consequence of the freedom of our behavior and of our choices. And so if you make the choice to go somewhere and you choose not to wear a mask, you have the consequence then that could be of getting sick or getting someone else sick or not. You are making a choice then when you go somewhere to wear a mask. You are making a choice whether to stay home or whether to go out. You really do have that freedom. Once we looked at it that way, she made a different choice about what was going on in her life at that time. So again, I think it's important as we have fears come up, as we have things that come up, to look at how we might use those denials and affirmations to really get to the root of what's going on. What is the real truth in this situation? And talking about prayer, I've noticed lately, because I'm home more, I think, and because my neighbors are home, I've been having conversations over the wall to the neighbors of the north and the south. We've been talking to each other. And often we will end our conversations with, I'll pray for you, or I'll pray for that, or I'll take that into my prayers. And I have a friend in India who requested prayers for her family. Her father passed away. He was sick. And I noticed when she, other people responded in the feed that the way she prays or the way her friends were praying is obviously different than what I've been taught. My neighbors are devout Catholics, so I know the way they pray is different than what we teach here. I know that we've heard on the news that we want to keep people in our thoughts and prayers. And I've said that with friends. I'll keep you in my prayers. I'll keep you in my thoughts. So what is the intention that we're saying when we say that to each other, especially when we know that how we see prayer is maybe different? But what is the underlying intention? I'm on a Facebook group that also says things. Instead of prayer, they'll say, send some woo for this situation. I think they want to get away from the traditional idea of God and prayer, but there's still something that they want. So what is that? What is that intention? Do we just say, I'll keep you in my thoughts and prayers and then walk away and that's it? I don't believe so. I believe that if I say to someone, I will hold you in my thoughts and prayers, I will pray for you, that I am making a verbal contract. I am making a verbal commitment. That means I will include them in my prayer time and in my heart space. That I will take time to consciously think about them and uplift them in my thoughts for their highest and best expression and experience. Prayer Like inclusion requires action. I can say, I'll pray for you. I can say, I celebrate diversity. I can say, I love everybody. I can say, I want a world that works for everyone. And I can say, let's pray for peace. But what actions need to take place behind those words? First and foremost, I believe we need to move into the action of prayer, really and truly taking the time to pray in whatever way works for us. Can we say, along with Ernest Holmes, I silently bless all who enter my atmosphere? And I believe when he says my atmosphere, he means my personal presence as well as my thought atmosphere. I personally bless, silently bless all who enter my atmosphere. And so as we talk about prayer and affirmative prayer, one of the things that we do is, like I said, we think about the condition, we turn away from that condition, recognize what God is, then we can do those affirmations and denials as we move through and really work with what's going on inside of us. And then we usually state everything that we're saying in the present tense, and we end with, and so it is. And a few weeks ago during our Q&A Sunday, someone sent me this question, and I saved it for this week. Since I was puzzled by this, perhaps others are. It has to do with the statement, and it already is so. I had taken that as a literal statement as opposed to an affirmation of sorts. In other words, why do we end our prayer with, and so it is, when we can't see the manifestation yet? That's a good question, and it's one that we get often, I think. So let's think about what it is we think we're doing when we're praying. In religious science, we don't believe that we're praying to a God out there that we're trying to convince to do something for us. That's not what we're doing. We believe that we are convincing ourselves of the fact that God the good is already in and through and around us. So we use terminology and language that helps our brain, ourselves, really get that. So that's why we put it in the affirmative. And that's why we state, and so it is. That convinces us of that truth that is already so out there, as we say, in the mind of God and within us. Ernest Holmes said that every thought sets the fulfillment of its desire in motion in mind, and mind sees the thing as already done. Page 355. In the Science of Mind text. And then in the back of the text, he said, it is not our business to outline, to say how our good shall come. Our work is to specifically set the law in motion. We should speak our word and believe that after it is spoken, it gathers unto itself whatever is necessary to its fulfillment. The law does the rest. And that was page 616. So when we state something in the present tense and when we affirm it by saying, and so it is, we've actionized our prayer. We've put the law in motion. We've started the ball rolling with our words. Now, given that we're talking about inclusion and diversity, I know that our way of praying is not the only way of praying. And this last week, a friend of mine sent me this book, Life Prayers, Affirmations to Celebrate the Human Journey. And these are from all around the world and all different ways of thinking. And so I thought I would share with you a few other thoughts on inclusion that are written by different points of views. This one is by Ted Loader, a retired United Methodist minister. Empower me to be a bold participant rather than a timid saint in waiting in the difficult ordinariness of now. To exercise the authority of honesty rather than to defer to power or deceive to get it. To influence someone for justice rather than impress anyone for gain. And by grace, to find treasures of joy, of friendship, of peace hidden in the fields of the daily you give me to plow. This one is by Ram Dass. I make the effort to maintain a ground of oceanic silence out of which arises the multitude of phenomena of daily life. I make the effort to see and to passionately open in love to the spirit that infuses all things. I make the effort to see the beloved in everyone and to serve the beloved through everyone, including the earth. I often fail in these aspirations because I lose the balance between separateness and unity, get lost in my separateness, and I feel afraid. But I make the effort. And finally, some thoughts from the Buddha. The thought manifests as the word. The word manifests as the deed. The deed develops into habit, and habit hardens into character. So watch the thought and its ways with care, and let it spring forth from love born out of concern for all beings. So different thoughts and different words. And yet I think if we look at that, what is the intention behind these prayers, these thoughts, and these ideas? What is your intention when you say to someone, I'll pray for you, or I'll keep you in my prayers? I encourage you to actionize your prayers by actually taking the time to do the prayer work. Again, in whatever way works for you, include into your prayers those whom you have promised to pray for. Include into your prayers those who you have pushed out of your heart space. Bring them back in. Include our world and governmental leaders. Include all who have impacted your life in some way. And as you pray, consider denying or turning away from actual conditions that cause fear or evil to appear in the world, and affirm and turn toward the truth, your spiritual truth, what you stand for, and celebrate that which is God's expression through all of diversity. Include in your prayer time some silence and listening, so as to discern the next right actions. As you actionize your prayers in this way, your prayers will guide you in action. And so it is. So I'm going to do a little different prayer today, again in the interest of inclusion. As we go into prayer and contemplation, I'm going to share with you these words from White Eagle, Hopi Indigenous. This is a message. So just take this in. This moment humanity is going through can now be seen as a portal and as a hole. The decision to fall into the hole or go through the portal is up to you. If you repent of the problem and consume the news 24 hours a day with little energy, nervous all the time, with pessimism, you will fall into the hole. But if you take this opportunity to look at yourself, rethink life and death, take care of yourself and others, you will cross the portal. Take care of your homes. Take care of your body. Connect with your spiritual house. When you are taking care of yourselves, you are taking care of everything else. Do not lose the spiritual dimension of this crisis. Have the eagle aspect from above and see the whole more broadly. There is a social demand in this crisis, but there's also a spiritual demand. The two go hand in hand. Without the social dimension, we fall into fanaticism. But without the spiritual dimension, we fall into pessimism and lack of meaning. You were prepared to go through this crisis. Take your toolbox and use all the tools available to you. Learn about resistance of the indigenous and African peoples. We have always been and continue to be exterminated, but we still haven't stopped singing, dancing, lighting a fire, and having fun. Don't feel guilty about being happy during these difficult times. You do not help at all being sad and without energy. You help if good things emanate from the universe now. It is through joy that one resists. And also, when the storm passes, each of you will be important in the reconstruction of this new world. You need to be well and strong, and for that, there is no other way than to maintain a beautiful, happy, and bright vibration. This has nothing to do with alienation. This is what is asked of you. Allow yourself to take advantage of this time to perform your vision-seeking rituals. What world do you want to build for? For now, this is what you can do. Serenity in the storm. Calm down. Pray every day. Establish a routine to meet the sacred every day. Good things emanate. What you emanate now is the most important thing. And sing and dance. Resist through art, joy, faith, and love. That's the end of the quote. And so I just know that as we heard these words, as we take them in, as we recognize that others around this world join us in visualizing a world that works for everyone, and seeing inclusion in action, celebrating the diversity of all of God's expression, that we are not alone, that we are part of a great movement. We are part of the reason that we are here right now. And so for that, I give great thanks, as I know that these words are already in action. Action is already taking place. And so I release these words with great gratitude as I hear all of us around this community saying together, and so it is.
When you're down and troubled, and you need some love and care, and nothing is going.
So I want to thank you again for joining us on this Sunday for this service that we've had together virtually. I love you. I just know that you're staying safe. Continue praying and doing that hard work. I love you all.